Hey up and welcome to another episode of Last Cast. You join us today at Sunrise Lakes just outside Harrogate, and we're going to go against the grain today and hopefully look to try and catch an Netta silverfish. It's a commercial fishery, but it doesn't hold quite as many carp as your average one. It's got a good head of perch, roach, rudd, skimmers, you know, a good mixture of silvers. So that's what we're going to look at targeting today. And we're going to employ a method that we've looked at before, but we're going to look at it in a bit more detail today, and that's whip fishing. In front of me, I've got three set up at 2, 3 and 5 metres. So what I'm going to do, because we didn't detail it in our previous video, which we'll put in the link below, I'm going to quickly run through how to attach a rig to the end of a whip. So the rigs I'm using today, I've got two short, sort of standard pole float type rigs, using pencil style floats, and those are going to be on the 2 and 3 metre whip. And I'm going to look at using a sliding float on the 5 metre line. So what I'll do is I'll get my rig here. Just take that off the winder. And as you can see at the top of the rig there, we've got two bits of silicone. These are 0.7mm. And obviously one short on the other, and a loop. So the first bit that we need to address is how to get the line round the whip. So what I do is use a loop that you'd use on a Dacron. So the main loop in the end of the main line that you'd usually attach over a stonfo. Just make a small loop in the line below that and pass it through like so. And that'll create a larger loop there. What I do is pass this over the top of the whip and behind a piece of silicon. That's a 0.5mm piece, and that fits really tight and snug on there. It's not going to move. And this is basically acting as the anchor point for the line. So I pull that down and it sits tight against the whip like so. And I just slide that up and bed it in neatly behind that piece of silicon. Then what I do is grab the first piece of silicone that's on the line, the top one, and this is about 10mm long, so shorter than the second piece. And that goes straight on the end of the whip, like so. And what I do is just slide that down towards that first piece and leave a small gap of about 2mm, and that's just to allow that knot there, as you can see, to pull through and tighten. That just sits nice and tight. Now that'll never move, but it's always best to be secure with these things. So what I do is then just wrap the line around the top of the whip just a few times. You can do this by twisting the whip itself or doing it in the fashion that I've just done it there. And then find the second piece of silicone, pull that up, and then just pop that over the top of the whip. Now the important thing is that's about a 20mm piece, and I've got 10mm on and 10mm off, and that just kicks the line out from the end. You'll see now I'll pull that tight, and that's never going to budge. So that's how you secure a rig to the end of a whip, nice and tight. And you can see, as opposed to using a stonfo, it actually spreads the load along the flick tip, so it's less likely to snap. So that's the rigs done. I'll quickly run through which ones we're using while I set this one up. But I've got, as I say, three lines to fish today. I've got a 2 metre line, which I'm going to fish with maggot. I've also got a 3 metre line, which is going to be just beyond that for use with caster. The idea there being that it's going to be used to sort of like allow the fish to back off. And I've got a 5 metre line out in open water over little nuggets of ground bait and caster as well. And that's going to be mainly sort of looking for skimmers and fish like that. So I'll just quickly get this on the whip like so, then run through the rigs. So rig-wise, we'll start with the short line. We've got 011 main line on this 2 metre whip, and we've got a pencil style float. That's a Colmic 4x12, similar to the Sensus desk style floats that I've got in here as well. Crucial thing is long fibre bristle, nice pencil body, wire stem, which is essential for casting weight, and it makes that float sit immediately. So that's what you're looking for. You don't want a carbon stem because you want that bait to be fishing immediately. I've got a spread bulk there, which weighs about 0.18 of a gram, with a couple of trimming shot, and then two number 10s below that. Now, I've started in that fashion to get the bait down, try and catch fish quickly on the bottom, but I've incorporated a lot of shot into the rig, so I'm able to spread that out and maybe use a strung out pattern or just bulk it all together above the hook length. As I say, 011 mainline there, coming down to an 08 hook length, and that's to a size 20 B511, and I've nipped the barb down on there. On commercials, you've got to use barbless hooks, so I use a pair of style pliers and nip the barb down. The 3 metre line is exactly the same, but just beefed up a bit. Same main line, same hook length, but size 18 hook for caster. 0.3 float. I prefer to go by a rule of using 0.1 of a gram per meter of whip that I'm using as a minimum, just to make life easier casting. Same again, strung bulk there, and I've got two number 10 droppers just bulked there. I might change it, as I say, as the day goes on, depending on how the fish are feeding according to temperatures and all the other variables. Now the 5 meter line is a bit different. Obviously I've got quite a way to cast this, so a standard pole float may work, but I want to get the line sunk behind the float if the wind does pick up. So starting from the top end, I've actually got an elastic in this just in case we do encounter carp or barbel, and that's a number 8 solid through the top two sections. Plenty strong enough for this, but it allows me to not bump the small fish. Moving down the line, we've come back to the sliding float method that you'll have seen us employ at Shelf Dam in a previous whip video. 013 main line, again slightly beefed up. Got a float stop there set at dead depth. Moving down, we've got a 0.125 waggler. Again, it's fairly heavy for the distance, but I just want to make sure I can always get there so I don't have to change the rig. Number 8's around a 0.8 Olivet, and that's going to make the bulk of about a gram or so. And then I've got four number 10 droppers incorporated into this rig, but I've set those right above the hook length because with using ground bait and caster, I want to make sure I'm getting the bait down immediately. If I'm missing bites or struggling for bites, then I'll play around with the shotting pattern. But that's a crucial aspect of whip fishing. With all your rigs, you want to incorporate as many shot as you can to be able to change the shotting pattern throughout the day to try and keep bites coming. Hook length on that is stepped up again. That's an 012 fluorocarbon hook length to a size 18 Drennan carp maggot hook. Nice and strong. It's a red hook, so if I'm fishing red maggot and caster, it's ideal for that. And as I say, I just want a bit of security in this rig in case I do hook some bonus fish. So that's all the rigs looked at. As I say, the lines are all in a direct line in front of me. When you're whip fishing, you don't want to be fishing off to the side, really. You want to have just one perfect line. So as I say, that's all sorted. So what we'll do now is start feeding, get into the session, and run you through the baits as we go. Right, so we're going to start off on the 2 meter line. The plan of action today is to try and catch fish short and then progressively, as they back off, catch them on the lines further out. That's why I've got the other two whips set up. The baits that we've got today, really dead simple, standard sort of whip fishing kind of stuff. We've got a pint and a half of red maggots with a few mixed in there just as a change hook bait. It's a good idea to have those, so you might want to catch on a fluoro or a white, something like that, just as a standout bait. Got a pint of caster, which is going to go on the 3 meter line and the 5 meter line, and some hemp as well, which will probably go towards the 5 meter line as well. So as I say, we'll go for the first chuck of the session. We've got a red maggot on there, and we'll just see what we can catch. So immediately I'm going to start loose feeding, but all I'm going to do is feed two or three maggots at a time. We lost a nice rud there, so that's not a bad start. As I said, we're just going to start loose feeding two or three maggots almost constantly to try and get that level of competition up. There's no point putting a load of bait down here because we're really trying to catch immediately. So obviously if you've only fed two or three maggots, then the chances are that the fish are more likely to make a mistake and take yours than if you fed, say, 20. It's getting bites straight from the off now. What I've done with this is I've plumbed up and I've started about 6 inches off the deck. I won't start on the deck because there is a risk of catching carp and fish like that. So I want to ideally avoid those. There is a fair head of carp in here, but obviously we're looking for silverfish today, so ideally I want to avoid those. Last thing you want to be doing is hooking a 5 pound carp on a 2 meter whip with a flick tip in. As I say, we're getting indications straight away, so we'll keep plugging away at this, and the plan is that if this starts to dry up, then we'll move towards that 3 meter line where I'll begin loose feeding casters as soon as this starts to look a bit iffy. So we've had a few perch to start off with, which is good. Hopefully we'll encounter a few better roach and rudd as the session goes on, maybe the odd skimmer on this line, but I'm not expecting lots of fish. That's a small skimmer there. It's just dropped in the net. As you can see today, we're using a keep net, which you're not usually allowed on here, but we've been given permission by the owners that run it kindly to use them and show you what we've caught at the end of the session. Once again, keep that loose feed going in. Last thing you want to do with this is go mad and put in a load of bait, because that's going to attract fish basically which you won't be able to land. See that perch dropped off there. That's the problem with perches, they've got quite bony mouths, and using barbless hooks they'll often fall off when you're swinging them to hand. So that's why ideally I want to be catching roach and rudd, to be honest. Still getting bites. Another thing you'll notice as well is I'm loose feeding over quite an area. You don't really want to go and concentrate the fish too much, because that's just going to increase the risk of them spooking. So if you spread the bait out a fair bit, they're going to have to chase it and search around, and then you're going to, as I say, increase the competition. It's a nice gudgeon, that. So it shows there's not too many large fish down there, but as long as you're putting a few ounces in the net constantly, that's the idea. So we'll keep plugging away at this, and once it starts to quieten down, we'll probably look at beginning that 3 metre line and loose feeding caster there. Oh, there's a better fish. I've just hooked what looks like a nice skimmer, fishing really shallow there. Took the bait immediately under the surface. What I'm going to do well is in the net, just feed a few more maggots. That's a lovely fish to catch, a real bonus on the whip there. It's a good 8 to 10 ounces, that. So the difference all of a sudden really has been after using that strung out shotting pattern. I've noticed I was getting a few silly bites on the drop. So what I've done is just changed the depth. I've taken another 6 inches off, so I'm fishing about 12 to 18 inches deep there. Put the bulk right under the float. And what I've done actually under all this slime is I've brought 3 number 10s down and put those right above the hook length. Before I was just fishing single number 10 droppers and I was missing a lot of bites. So usually if you use a bigger dropper like that, you get a much more positive indication and therefore you tend to hit more bites. So that's a useful tip there to incorporate into your fishing. Because if you start missing bites like that on the whip, increase the size of your dropper, bring some more shot into play there and shallow up, and usually it'll pay off as it has done there for me. Getting bites immediately now, and they're really positive indications on the float. There's none of this with the float bristle rising and falling. It's just pulling under immediately. Still keeping the same feeding pattern going, but I'm just going to start loose feeding a few casters on that 3 metre whip line. Probably feeding 5 or 6 casters there to every 2 lots of feed that I put on this 2 metre line. And if the fishing starts to go a bit funny, then I'll just reverse that and feed twice on the caster line and once on the maggot line. But this style of fishing, it's all about keeping a high work rate with what you're doing, changing the shotting, changing hook baits, and just looking to really maximise the amount of bites that you're hitting and fish that you're putting in your keep net. So if you're fishing this in a match, that's the only way that you're going to beat people catching carp and larger fish, is to increase the amount of fish that you're catching and keep that up over the 5 hour period of the match. Had that bream on a fluorescent maggot, which I think might be another thing to look at using, is contrast hook baits. Because I seem to be getting quicker bites when I'm using a fluoro maggot than I am on a red maggot. Small roach this time. As long as you keep catching fish like that, then you're always putting weight in your keep net. Try a fluoro maggot this time, just see if that produces a quicker bite. There we go. That looks like a nice roach, this. It's gone a bit quieter on this line. I believe it's due to the bankside disturbance, but we're still fishing that same depth. That's a nice quality roach, that. So I'll pop him in the net, and I think what I'll do now, I'll keep feeding this sparingly, but what I'll do is I'll go onto the 3 metre whip line and see if there's any fish there to be had on the caster. Let's pop this to one side and see if there's anything to be had where I've been loose feeding those casters. What I've done is I'll start on a maggot there, but what I've done is I've fed fair handfuls of caster over that line while I've been fishing the 2 meter whip. And I'm starting just on depth with a single red maggot, so had a bite immediately there, nearly tore the pole out of my hand. There's definitely a few fish out there, and what he's done is doubled the hook point over the mag, the maggot over the hook point there, so I suspect that was a quality roach. So at the moment I'm catching on single maggot over the casters, and it appears that there's a better stamp of roach down there. So while I'm at it, what I'm going to do is just keep up that same feeding pattern. If it's working, stick with it. Putting in 15-20 casters each put out, and hopefully those will get to the bottom and settle. So in conjunction with that, rig wise I've got a bulk and a large dropper. You can see smaller fish this time, but generally the stamper fish has been better there. It may be a line where I might pick up a few skimmers. So the idea behind feeding this line was that once that 2 meter line started to dry up, as it has, they've backed off and been able to settle over the casters that I've been feeding, which has resulted in a better stamper fish settling there. Usually the bigger fish are usually warier, and I think giving them an area to feed over like that is why I'm catching this better stamper fish. So we'll keep plugging away at this, and hopefully we might encounter a few bigger fish as well. And then once these start to spook, then I'll look to start introducing some feed on that 5 meter whip line, and hopefully that's where we'll catch an even bigger stamper fish. A small gudgeon this time. It may be a case that I have to move on to the caster if catching fish like that persists, but what I'm going to do is, just in case there's a skimmer down there, I'm just going to try a couple of maggots dead. Because these are inert, they'll probably get to the bottom without being attacked so much by the small fish, so I'm just trying a dead floor run, a dead red pinky on there. Just see if this makes any difference. Got a bit of a ripple on the water now, and the wind's blowing into our face, so that's always a good thing. So hopefully the fish should start to feed. Got a bite there. This 0.3 bulk is just heavy enough to get that bait down to where it needs to be. But if the wind picks up there, I might have to put on a 0.4 or maybe a 0.5. And perhaps even introduce using a sliding float method as well. Small perch this time. Another thing is the bites are a lot more confident over this line as well. I'm missing a lot fewer than I was fishing short on the 2 meter whip shallow. I'm just going to try contrast bait with double maggot, because we have seen a little bit of fizzing down there. So if there's a skimmer down there, I'd like to try and catch it using a target bait, something a bit larger that might attract its attention. So because I've also fed that caster line over a more general area, I can fish around it and hopefully pick fish off around without spooking the shoal too much. I'm also just going to keep occasionally tricking a few maggots in on that 2 meter line, because you never know, if this dries up I might have to come short again. Look like a line bite there. Better fish, looks like a roach this one. So these are the stamp fish that you're looking for on this kind of line. 2 or 3 ounces, but they'll build your weight a lot quicker than, say, if you're catching those 2 ounce gudgeon and roach and perch on that short line. So these are the decisions that you've got to make when you're fishing the whip, is to try and catch the larger fish, sorry. But equally try and keep a good rate of bites going. I
Oh, we're into a bream here. That's a nice fish. Just slipped a caster on there. This is a lovely fish to be catching on the whip. Oh no, actually it's a crucian, this one. I thought it looked like a bream, that. Just got to be careful because we're only on a 0.08 hook length. Just got to take it really careful. See, lovely soft action on these whips. You can catch these fish fairly quickly. That's a lovely fish to catch. Just hold him up for camera. Lovely crucian carp there. Get him unhooked and put in the keep net. There's a fish. Right, got a bream. Had to wait a while for that bite, but that's why the swim's gone quiet. Nice skimmer. Right, so as you can probably see the amount of fizzing there, I'm going to pick up this 5 metre whip. Just have a cast over the top of that, see what's down there. So I suspect it's probably some skimmers, but you never know. So what I'm going to do is slip on a fluoro maggot and a red. Rig-wise, I've got a good solid gram bulk, and I've got 4 number 10s just above the hook length. So that's going to be able to give me good lift bites. So I'm just going to overcast the area, pull that float back and sink the line. Being that it's a sliding float, you'll be able to see that that's settling fairly quickly and the droppers are taking up and there's a bite immediately there. We've got a fish on. Small roach taking that. So if that's the case, I may well have to use dead maggots or a combination of casters and maggots just to get through them. So definitely plenty of fish down there. Sinking that line. Small fish is taking it again on the drop. I may have to really bring the bulk down even closer to the hook length if that's the case. So that's settled now. See the float's moving side to side quite a bit. Bit of an indication there. There's plenty of fish in the peg. I'm fishing this rig just a couple of inches over depth just to make sure that that bait's getting down. Plenty of movement on the float from the fish. So the feed that I've introduced there has been a mix of F1 by Sonia Bateson combined with Census Lake Black, and I've just loaded that with tons of caster just to make sure that there's plenty of food content down there for them. So I'm going to keep loose feeding over that 3 metre whip line as well, just every so often introducing some bait there. There's definitely a few fish down there though at the moment. Hopefully I'll be able to get a bait down there and keep it down there for the fish to browse around and hopefully take it confidently. And I think loose feeding over this line might be a recipe for disaster, bringing fish at all levels. A bit of a lift on the float there. And while I'm waiting for a bite on this, just going to keep that loose feed going in. Getting plenty of line bites. There's a fish on now. Small skimmer. Getting good quality fish to be catching on the whip. That'll certainly help build your weight very quickly. So I think this cast, I'm going to try a cast a tip with a maggot, just see if that brings anything a bit larger. Because I'm sure there are some bigger fish down there, it's just a case of trying to get through to them. And just keeping those casters going in. There's a lift bite there. A lot of these may be line bites. So that float sat right in the middle of all the fizzing. When I cut the balls in, I've actually cut them out with a bit of a spread, again, because unlike with a pole, you're not fishing particularly accurately. It allows the fish to just browse, and especially with bream and things like that, they're a shoal fish and you want to be able to allow them to spread out and browse for food particles. You're a lot more likely to get bites then. See, now there's plenty of activity in the peg. I may even up it to using three maggots on the hook or something like that, just as a big target bait. There's a fish. That's a carp. Or is it? Might be a big bream. Just hooked into a good fish here. I've had to wait a while for that bite. It might be a large bream, this. You can see that number 8 elastic working nicely. Whatever it is, it's a good quality fish. It might be a carp, I'm not entirely sure, to be honest. So I've had a load of bubbles come up, and I suspect those were larger carp that have possibly spooked whatever was down there. And this, whatever it happens to turn out to be, has just fallen to three maggots. Just changed to a larger bait, more visual target bait for the fish to find. It seems to have worked here. So I take it really careful, because we're only fishing of light hook lengths and light lines. This seems like a small carp, actually. Just plodding around. There it is, small carp. Nice little mirror. Makes a change to the roach that we've been having, but that's probably why the swim's gone a bit quiet there, is possibly a few carp have moved in. So yeah, we're using a separate net for the carp rather than the silvers. So obviously you don't want to go mixing the larger fish with the small roach. So after that, I think what I'll do is I'll have another go there. Put on three maggots again, and hopefully we might be able to catch another one. So as you can see, I'm back on this 3 metre line now. As you can probably tell, the sun's come out and it's rendered the 5 metre line fairly useless. We've had a few small carp, a few skimmers, a few roach, but it's not really been too hectic there. There's been plenty of activity from the fish, but I think they've become unsettled. They've come off bottom and that's produced a lot of line bites. So I've dropped onto this 3 metre line where I've been loose feeding casters. I've just switched to loose fed maggots now and I'm seeming to get a bite of chuck. Had a few quality roach, a small skimmer, and a decent bream as well. So it seems to be the line that's producing the most at the moment. The two meter whip I might employ a bit later, but it depends, to be honest. I think the 3 meter line is where the fish are happiest to be. So we're only fishing about a foot off the bottom, just loose feeding, and it seems to be producing quite well. I may even come shallower as the temperature warms up, but as it stands, I'm getting plenty of bites as the rig's set at the moment. And I'm hitting most of them as well. It's a nice roach again. These are the sort of stamp fish that we've been catching on this line, and I think these have really responded to the hemp and caster, to be honest. I think that's what's brought them into the peg. And those will really help boost the weight at the end of the day. You can see that with the temperature warming up, I'm having to work a lot harder in terms of frequency of casting, how much I'm feeding. You can see some good swirls coming up. There's plenty of fish down there at the moment. I think if we keep working at this line, we may encounter a few better fish as well. Again, this was the line that I started by loose feeding heavily with hemp and caster on the bottom. There's a bream now. I started loose feeding with hemp and caster on the bottom, but as the temperature's increased, I believe those fish have still stayed over that line. But while I've been fishing the 5 meter line and loose feeding hemp and caster, they've just come a bit shallower, and that's why I'm catching them now, feeding incredibly confidently. So I've got down the line, I'm fishing a bulk and just two number 10 droppers, but I've put those together just above the hook length to increase the level of bite indication. As you can see, it's a fisher chuck there now. And this, when you're fishing like this, you can really start to put a weight together very quickly. As long as you get into a good rhythm of feeding, casting and catching fish, then you can soon put a few pounds in the net. So I think the 2 meter line might just be a bit too close for them, and the better fish have just stayed that bit further out. So hopefully I'll be able to make the most of this spell and catch some of these quality fish. There's plenty of good swills in the peg now. It's a nice perch, this one. It seems there's quite a few fish coming even shallower in that on that line, so I may have to move the bulk down a little bit and just see what I can catch. See, I've upped the feed a bit now, so it seems there's quite a few fish there, so I want to make sure that I can get plenty of fish in the peg competing for the feed. Certainly have plenty of fish now shallow, taking the bait before it even gets down. Surprisingly, there's a lot of these fish are perch actually. They're taking the bait at really quite a shallow depth. So I'm probably feeding 7 or 8 maggots almost constantly now. Just trying to get those fish competing higher in the water. Float's constantly moving. Another indication there. Big swirl behind the float, missed it. Those could be eyed, or even big roach or skimmers. So as long as I keep this feed going in, there's a chance that I might hook one of them. Looks like a nice roach, this. Might just be able to swing in. There we go, lovely quality fish.
just hooked in the bottom lip, which tells me that I've actually, he's probably taken that on the drop. So again, that might be an indication that I may need to shallow up. So I'll carry on like this, and if I start missing bites, then I'll probably take another 2 or 3 inches off the depth and see if that increases the amount of bites I get to the amount that I actually hit and connect with into another fish now. Another small perch, plenty of these in the peg at the moment. So hopefully with an increase in feed, I might be able to feed these off a little bit. Still worth catching though. Just going to try a contrast bait now in the form of a fluoro maggot, just see if that brings a quicker bite. And it has, so that was a better fish that time. Could have been a skimmer, not too sure. Definitely a quality fish though, that. As you can see now, getting almost a bite of chuck, so this is when you want to start chopping and changing between hook baits and see if you can sort out a few better fish. If I keep connecting with bites at this rate, then I'm probably not going to change the depth because it shows that I'm doing something right. Plenty of good fish swirling now. Just going to keep that feed going in. Nice small rud that time. Swirls behind the float all the time now. Missed a couple of bites there, so I may bring another dropper down to increase the weight of that small bulk near the hook. Another perch that time, so I may well shallow up this time. So what I'm going to do is bring another number 10 down, just take another 2 inches off the depth, see if that changes anything. Definitely an area where the fish are happy to settle is that 3 metre line. It bites every single time the float goes in now. Another nice roach. Maybe just net this one. Quality fish. You can see there I've always got my disgorger to hand just to speed the process up. See how quickly, that's the advantage with the whip, of how quickly I've hooked that fish, landed it, got it in the keep net and back out again. Starting to miss a couple of bites now. I'm just going to feed 5 or 6 maggots almost constantly now. I've shallowed up as well again. There's a better fish now. It's really fighting this. I'm not sure what it is. Could be a big roach or it's a hybrid actually. That's why it's fighting so hard. Lovely fish. Quality fish to catch that. So that's certainly responded then just to the increase in feed. Can often spark these fish into feeding a lot more aggressively. front bite straight away again. So I'm going to persist with this more aggressive feeding pattern and just hopefully might be able to put a run of quality fish together. Taking the bait as soon as it hits the water now. It's another good fish. Nice roach. With the increase in feed, certainly these bigger fish have turned up all of a sudden. Probably going 3 or 4 to the pound, these, which can really make a difference to the weight at the end of the day. I think with the warmer temperatures, they really have come on the feed shallow. Nice little perch there. Right, we're into a good fish here. Feels like another hybrid. It's actually a skimmer, this one. Catching these just over a foot deep at the moment. Quality fish. Ever since I've shallowed up and started increasing the level of feed, the larger fish really have shown a lot more. A few more quality roach hybrids and even a bream there. There's one. Right, we've just hooked into a nice roach here. I think we'll probably call this the last one of the session. We've had about 5 or 6 hours today and put a good net full together. Quality fish, a real mixed bag. We've also had a couple of carp as well and F1s, so what we'll do, we'll probably put the F1s and carp straight back and we'll have a look at the silvers and weigh in and see what we've caught today. So catch us up the bank and we'll see what we've had. Right, so that's what we've caught today. That's our final net of fish there. As you can see, probably anywhere from 20 plus pound of silvers in there. Got some nice skimmers, a mixture of roach, rudd, plenty of perch as well. So hopefully today this has given you an idea of how you can employ the whip method on commercial fisheries. It's a good idea through the mid part of a match, say the carp out playing ball or whatever it may be. You can target these fish and put a good net together. So hopefully you've enjoyed the episode, maybe learnt a few things, and we'll catch you on that next episode. And don't forget to subscribe.